Hello, I'm David Riddle, and welcome to our YouTube channel, How to Home Life. And welcome to my machine shop, where I build all kinds of custom equipment for professionals all over the world. Today, we're going to answer many, many questions that were posed on our beginner glue video, and my partner, John Schneider, who's also my producer, will ask the questions.
Thanks, Dave. So we got about 25 questions here, and we're really thankful for all our subscribers on the how-to video and the beginner's video. And we do have a lot of interest, a lot of questions, and so we're going to try to run through these as fast as possible. But Dave, I think the probably the most asked question was, how do you seal the bottle when you're done? A lot of people didn't understand, like, what happens, will it dry up, and what's the expiration date? But let's talk about how do you keep the bottle? What do you do? Do you take the Teflon tube out? What happens?
No, absolutely not. The reason is that cyanoacrylate is an anaerobic cement, meaning it won't cure when there's air around it. And so it doesn't go bad in the bottle. If you need to transport the bottle, you simply take a straight pin and stick it in the end of the Teflon tube so it won't leak out. That's it. You can just leave it out. I've left it out for months and it doesn't ever change the cyanoacrylate. And if you're really concerned, you can put a pin in it and put it in your refrigerator or freezer, but you have to let it warm up before you use it again. So I generally don't ever do that. I only keep my 8-ounce refill in the freezer and then I fill the bottle up, the 2-ounce bottle.
Do you sometimes let the glue like close up at the very tip of the tube, or it doesn't
matter? No, I don't worry about any of that. Okay. That's not a problem. It's okay. Anaerobic cement. It's designed to have air above it. That's why you always leave an air gap in when using CA when you fill the bottle. Never fill it all the way to the top. Always fill it with about two-thirds or three-quarters full.
Okay. Hopefully that answers that question. If you have more questions on that, just put it in the comments. Again, we appreciate all these great comments. Dave, does the accelerant only harden the surface of the glue, or has the whole thing become hardened?
No, actually what happens is it starts an exothermic reaction that propagates all through the glue joint. And so you really need to only put a very small amount of accelerant on the glue joint, and it's very rapid. Now, not all glue joints require accelerant. Some do, some don't. But generally what I do is I accelerate it only because I want to work more quickly.
Dave, a couple of people asked about whether the joint can be flexible, because we showed us gluing leather and some other flexible issues. Is there a way to make it flexible, or is it not flexible at
all? It's really not that very flexible at all. In fact, when I glue the leather, it's very stiff. And if you glue cloth or anything else, it's going to be very rigid and stiff. Yes, it's not really designed to be flexible. There's other glues that you can use if you want flexibility in that glue joint. Generally, cyanoacrylate cures very rigidly.
When you say other glues, are these other forms of crazy glue, or
typically elastomeric type glues that are designed to be flexible?
Excellent. Okay, let's go over to our Ikea video. Many of you watched the Ikea video. Thank you. Dave, you didn't glue the posts. Someone asked if the posts can be unscrewed after. Also, I think this is an obvious no, but they asked, can you disassemble the IKEA furniture?
Well, you can't disassemble it because I glue all the other joints. But if you, and we're going to be showing in another video the use of strip screws into wood and how to solve those. If you ever need to take a screw out, all you have to do is heat it with a soldering gun or a high wattage soldering iron, because what happens is that the glue becomes very soft when it's heated above about 250 to 400 degrees, it becomes quite soft and you can disassemble it. But the IKEA furniture, no. Once you use all the glue and all the joints, only a sledgehammer will bust it apart.
All right. Somebody, it sounded like they were being flippant, Dave, but they said it looked like you were using more glue in the IKEA video than what the actual furniture was worth. But address that. Was the glue use expensive?
The glue that I used was about $10 for the whole bottle. We used about 3/4 of a bottle in that video. And so in reality, $7.50 making the furniture last forever versus making it last for maybe 8 months, as far as I'm concerned, the glue is absolutely worth it.
Got it. Okay, we got a lot of questions about different materials, but I think this was the biggest one, second biggest one maybe. Can you glue plastic to metal?
Yes, of course you can glue plastic to metal, but there's all kinds of different plastics. Now, polyethylene plastic, which is like flexible milk bottle kind of plastic. That doesn't stick. Glue doesn't stick to the cyanoacrylate doesn't stick to that at all. It's basically will not stick. Whereas other plastics such as ABS and PVC and many other types of plastic, mostly rigid plastic, will glue fine to metal and to itself.
Okay, somebody asked whether they could glue their rear view mirror to the glass window, which means metal to glass.
Well, that particular glue is a special cyanoacrylate glue that's different than the cyanoacrylate ether glue that I use. It's generally specialized glue, and it comes with the replacement mirror, or you can go to your auto parts store and get it. I wouldn't recommend using this glue for that application.
Okay, maybe we'll do something later on that, folks. Sorry about that. Somebody asked a question, said, what do you think about JB Weld?
Well, I actually have been using JB Weld for almost as many years as cyanoacrylate. JB Weld is simply epoxy that has dissolved or fine particle steel involved in it. And I use both types, both JB Weld Quick and JB Weld 24-hour type glue, depending on the particular application. And it is a very useful and very effective glue when used properly. Now remember, all epoxy glue needs to have a tooth. That is something roughed up so that it has the ability, because it's not a molecular bond generally that takes place. It's a tooth bond, meaning that the intermingling of the surfaces. And so I sand with 60 grit paper, both materials, and then I butter both pieces using the JB Weld, and then I put it together.
Okay, so that sounds like a future video for us, right?
Yes.
Okay. Somebody asked, Dave, will you be comparing thin glue to thick glue? And what's your thoughts on thick, in general, on thick glue versus water-thin glue?
Well, I exclusively use water-thin glue because I've never found that the thick glue penetrates. And what I'm really interested in is penetrating in the most minute areas that enhance the bond. And so I'm not an expert on anything except water-thin cyanoacrylate.
Back to materials. Somebody asked, I think we already showed this, but can you glue rubber?
Yes. In fact, it's been used for years for rubber. We show in the intro of that beginner's video where we show two pieces of rubber being glued together and then stretching it. Yes. They also make O-rings. This is a standard procedure for making custom O-rings of different sizes. I always use a salami slice, just like I do for the Teflon tubing. I make two salami slices. I put the two pieces of O-ring together and then a very super sharp razor blade and cut straight down. And so I get a much larger surface area. It also acts during the sealing process when the O-ring is used. The other thing that I've used is I've actually worn out shoes on the outside because they had a soft sole, and I glued rubber strips onto the bottom of the sole, and they never fell off. Just water-thin cyanoacrylate, stick it onto the sole of your shoe, and it will not detach. I don't know how it does it, but it does an incredibly good job.
Okay, can I say that we did answer the question on O-rings?
Yes.
So that's answered. Okay, let's talk about safety. There was a lot of comments and questions about safety. People mentioned that it could ruin your eyes. They also mentioned having lung issues with some of the reactions. So the question is, first question is, Dave, do you wear safety glasses, yes or no, when you're gluing?
Well, generally, because I'm presbyopic at 71, I always have reading glasses, which act as a safety shield for my eyes. Now, as far as respirators and other things required for this and other types of shielding for your eyes, I don't disagree. If you are sensitive to those things, I'm insensate, I'm told. So it doesn't
affect me. By his wife, tells him that all the time.
Yes, well. Anyway, so please use whatever safety equipment you think is necessary.
Okay, Dave, what about expiration date on the glue?
Well, I do realize that after many, many months, the water-thin glue will start to get thicker, and that's time to dispose of it. And so you really need to get a new glue bottle and not use the old glue bottle and refill it. Use new glue. As far as the big 8-ounce refill that I buy, I keep that in the freezer. I've had it for 6 months to a year, and it still works perfectly.
Are you not? So you don't need to look at the expiration date.
I'm not interested in the expiration date because, A, it's not stated on the BSI products.
Got it. Question, when gluing china, I found that it fails after going through the dishwasher. Any thoughts?
Well, that's because of the fact that, cyanoacrylate is not waterproof. And if you put it in a hot, heated dishwasher with soap, it's going to dissolve. And so, no, it is not appropriate for certain china repairs. It's only for decorative china repairs where you're not going to ever wash that piece. It works perfectly for that application, but trust me, if you're going to put it in a dishwasher, it's going to fail and fall apart.
Got it.
Because
okay.
it's not waterproof.
Got it. Okay. Why Bob Smith, and are there other manufacturers of this, but why Bob Smith over other manufacturers?
Well, the only reason that I use Bob Smith, it was available at the local hobby shop, and then I started buying it online. But the point is that I haven't, I had experimented with other products, but generally they're not water thin. And the only place I've been able to find water thin cyanoacrylate is from Bob Smith Industries.
Got it. What about debonding, acetone? You talked about heating. Let's talk about debonding.
Well, debonding is, in fact, BSI makes a product called Uncure, and it's basically a solvent that dissolves the crazy glue. It does it slowly. It doesn't do it instantly. It's not like other solvents. It slowly allows you to wipe away glue, and the debonder is very effective.
Okay. Can I use baking soda as an accelerant? What about carbon powder as well? Other accelerants?
Well, listen. The point is that baking soda is great, except for the fact that it mars the finish. You can't literally use baking soda and have a cosmetic finish versus letting it go into a crack and then using accelerator. Yes, baking soda will accelerate it. You can also mix water with baking soda. My problem is if you mix water with baking soda and use it as a curing agent or accelerator, now the object you want to work on is now wet and it takes a long time to dry, whereas the solvent that BSI uses in their accelerator it evaporates very rapidly, and it's not a consideration.
What about other materials like graphite?
Well, you know, I mean, yes, there's all kinds of porous materials that can be utilized along with cyanoacrylate, especially water thin glue. It's much, much easier to use basically baking soda because it's very cheap and it's very effective in its curing properties.
Got it. Okay, another question. Removing drips on clothes.
Well, this is a problem because what happens when the fibers instantly cure the glue, and now when you, after repeated washings, you'll find a hole in that cloth because it's not flexible because of the agitation within the washing machine eventually breaks all the fibers that are rigidly held together with crazy glue. The way to solve that problem is to literally use Uncure on the cloth and very carefully back it with a paper towel and pour little bits of it on the thing and pat it and get it to get rid of that glue and make it sure that it's all flexible afterwards.
Got it. Dave, why not apply CA glue on the surface of the materials before joining them rather than flooding it?
Well, the reason that I do that is it already has all soaked in, so there's no real glue left. It all soaks specifically with wood. But if you're gluing other objects, yes, of course you can put a little tiny bit of glue on both surfaces and then bring them together. I always find it much easier to hold the objects exactly where I want them to be affixed and then add the glue in a tiny bit along that joint. That's why I do it. And it also capillaries directly into all the cracks and crevices.
All right, is accelerator just a time saver or does it add to the strength of the bond?
It does not add to the strength of the bond. In fact, letting it cure slowly gives a stronger bond. But many times I use accelerator, especially in my woodworking. Why? Because of the fact it rapidly allows me to progress on a project. I want to get to the end of the project as quickly as possible.
Does the accelerator affect the finish of, let's just talk about wood, but other materials like say if you're on metal, but can it affect the surfaces?
Well, yes and no. Generally, the accelerator does not affect plastic surfaces. That's why people have tried to use acetone, but acetone is a very aggressive solvent which will dissolve many plastics and many paints. The only thing I've ever found that the accelerator removes is clear spray lacquer. That's the only thing I've found that it includes. It, normally, when you spray it on plastics of any type, it doesn't affect the plastics at all. That's the problem with acetone. You can't use it on plastics because it'll definitely damage the plastic surface.
Got it. Okay, we did have a lot of questions about can you fix this, can you fix that, and one of them was a bowling ball, one of them was a pool cue stick. But Dave, talk about some of the future videos we're going to make, because we are going to address these fun topics, but talk about that. I mean, can you glue a chip in a bowling ball?
Well, yes, you can. I mean, the point is you can use it as a filler for all kinds of things.
Baking soda? With baking soda would be the filler, or what's the filler?
No, not necessarily. Just the glue itself in the case of the bowling ball, but in the case of you have a large divot in wood, you can actually use baking soda and then sand it, and then I actually I stain the thing with permanent markers, and then I use graining and all kinds of different things to conceal a damaged piece of wood, say.
Excellent. Okay, that's pretty much all of our questions, but we did have one other interesting question, and this is a dangerous question for Dave, and I'll stop him when he starts pontificating. But Dave, a big question was, what are some of your other inventions?
Well,
and try not to go for 3 hours.
Well, my first product was developed when I was 20 years old, and that was the vacuum-tuned system for synchronizing carburetors on multi-cylinder motorcycles. That was the very first product that I designed, manufactured, and marketed across the U.S. and the world. I've done many things, both in mechanics, electronics, and optics. And if you ever saw the movie Forrest Gump, my camera was used to integrate Tom Hanks into those old movie reels. The way they did it is that the cinematographer utilized my specialized Polaroid cameras, which I did 10,000 of those cameras, put my two kids through university, gave it to my junior high school friend, put his three kids through university with one idea. That's the power of ideas.
Okay, really quick, we're going to make a link to this. Dave has done a couple of videos on his audio theater, and which we're going to link to those, so you can see an amazing audio. Just give us a brief description of the audio theater, Dave.
Well,
and we will have a link to that.
I built my first piece of audio gear when I was 7. I built my first loudspeaker when I was 14. I've been designing and building audio equipment for the last, well, a long, long time.
Yeah, but let's talk about the theater.
Okay. Specifically, the culmination of myself and my other design partners were the chief engineers for JBL and Sirwin-Vega, and one of my partners designed this single most successful JBL speaker in the world called the JBL Synthesis. He was the creator of it. It was his idea. He brought it all the way to market. It won all these awards, but it still wasn't satisfied for Dan Seifert. And if you go to their videos, you will see a complete explanation. There's two videos. One's a 10-minute, one's a 15-minute. You watch those videos, and you will hear the very first time a fully engineered sound reproduction facility has ever been built on this planet.
Well, I think that's it for most of our questions. Dave, do you have anything you want to add as far as any other questions in your mind that came up? And by the way, Dave is trying to answer all the questions as fast as possible. But any other comments, Dave?
Well, basically, I just want to also, like John, thank all of the YouTube subscribers who signed up to our site. And it's very exciting to be able to do this and share all of the knowledge that I've gained through all of these years of being an independent inventor, designer, and manufacturer of custom-made products for professionals all over the world. And I'm looking forward to hearing all of your questions and comments.
Yep, and thank you, Dave. And then again, please subscribe and like this video and put in the comment sections any other videos you wanna see. You wanna see something glued to something, let us know and we'll make that video. We just made a video about a chair. Tell them about the chair really quick.
Well, the chair, basically, a wooden chair always becomes wobbly because the tenon and mortise joints get loosened because of the way the wood fibers are. They eventually break away from the glue because the glue only penetrates a tiny bit. What I do is clamp everything together on the loose chair and then flood the joints and then accelerate it. And now you have a totally rigid chair that will not fail again. Why? Because it's soaked in 10 times deeper than the regular glue did from the factory. And now it's totally rigid and will never fail. Unless you want to use a sledgehammer.
All right, folks. Thanks again for watching this video. We appreciate you.
And thank you.